Welcome to the A-Game Podcast with Nick Lamagna, digging into the minds and experiences of some of today's brightest entrepreneurs in real estate and business, along with Hollywood stars, UFC fighters, and your favorite rock bands. People that have figured out how to overcome obstacles, take chances, live boldly, and no matter what they do, they always bring their A-game.
All right, my guest today on the A-Game Podcast is Tommy Haar. Tommy Haar is not only a real estate ninja, but he is an internet sensation. This guy is killing it on social media. He's got amazing content. He's got a huge following. He's bringing it every single day. He's flipping properties. He's wholesaling properties. He's bringing on rentals. He's doing the burst strategy. He's raising private money. He's having VAs do all this stuff for him. Like, this guy is crushing it right now. And we were lucky enough to get him. We became friends. We're in some masterminds together. I think we actually even connected before the mastermind, but guy's been awesome. Young dude, killing it. Very humble, comes from a great background. And I think he's going to be one of the biggest names in real estate in the next couple of years. So don't forget where you heard about him first, but I definitely expedited this. So if you guys are sitting there and you're thinking about getting into rehabbing, getting into wholesaling, he's offering a course coming up. I don't get anything from it. He gave you guys a discount. I didn't ask him for anything for it, but I like what he's doing. So he'll be in Ohio doing a 2-day event. I believe it's $2,000. He'll talk about that, but shoot him a message on Instagram or just check the show notes. Again, I'm not getting anything from it. I'm probably going to be there, but reach out to him because he's going to go over a bunch of things. He'll talk about it at the end of what they teach there, how you can get involved, plugging you into his system. So definitely a guy that you should be watching and following right now because you want to see people that are doing actual deals today. And with his 150 rehabs, 100 plus wholesale deals, 65 rentals, guy knows what he's doing. So appreciate Tommy Haar coming on. Guy could not be nicer. Just a cool, humble, good dude, kicking butt, taking names, and just inspiring people. So I appreciate him coming on. I love this interview. I feel lucky because he doesn't do a ton of these. So we got him. We got him before the word gets out, if it hasn't gotten out already with the social media. But definitely check the show notes for all the ways to connect with him. Definitely reach out to him directly about potentially taking his class in December or whenever the next one comes around. I highly recommend it. On top of that, subscribe to the podcast. The way we get these amazing guests like Tommy Haar to come on and share their wins and their losses and help you guys save time and make money is by subscribing to the podcast. So nicknicknick.com/links, LINKS, will get you all the ways to subscribe to this podcast. It's everywhere. You can watch it on YouTube. You can listen to it everywhere. Take a minute, subscribe to it, follow it. It really, really, really helps us. If you get a minute and you're feeling fancy, maybe leave a review. On top of that, interact with us on social media. So whether it's Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, whatever it might be, on nicknicknick.com/links, you'll find all the ways to connect with us on social media. I highly encourage you, please. I know you're sick of hearing about the algorithms, but it really goes a long way for us as podcasters. When follow us on Instagram, I'll follow you back. If I'm not popping up on your feed, write something to me. I'll write back to you. We'll start coming up on each other's feeds. But when I post clips from this episode, the way we keep getting amazing guests like Tommy on is when he sees that you like the post, he sees you comment with the post, ask him a question, share it, tag a friend. You're scrolling on social media all day anyway. Let Tommy know you're watching it so that when somebody asks, he can say, yes, I went on that show. People loved it. I made an impact. You should definitely go on and do the same. So that's how we keep the party going. But the big thing here is I want to do real estate together. So either send me a direct message on social media that says real estate so I know to look for it, or just text me the word real estate. Either way, whether it's social media or you want to text me, the number would be 516-540-5733. Again, 516-540-5733 to text me directly to figure out if you want to buy properties from me, if you want to sell properties to me, or if you just want to partner on some level, reach out to me. Let's get that conversation going. And last but certainly not least, nicknicknick.com/biggerpockets. We'll get you a free checklist for any of your buyers. If you're a real estate agent, broker, or wholesaler, a way to get more value to your buyers, jump on, get that for free today. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you so much, Tommy Haar. Look forward to seeing you soon. Thank you, Matt Andrews, for putting an amazing mastermind together. A-Game Podcast, ladies and gentlemen. Have a fantastic day. All right, my guest today is a former D1 athlete fighting out of Crickerton, Ohio, one of five kids, the son of an entrepreneur who climbed his way through the ranks of being a home inspector and property preservationist, and then transitioned his drive and discipline from soccer to a career in real estate investing. He is now even a social media star, which I'm sure he doesn't want to be referred to, but that's what happened. He's got over 65 rentals valued over $15 million, 25 short-term rentals managed in-house, done over 100 wholesale deals, renovated over 150 properties, accumulated well over $1 million in profits and revenues, and growing. He's actually involved his entire family in the process as well, leading him to be featured twice on Business Insider in 2022. He is now building a community where he's teaching others to find the success he has found, called the Real Side Real Estate Education, where he has over 110 members and has coached over 250 students and counting. My mastermind brother, welcome to the A-Game Podcast, Tommy Haar.
Dude, thanks for having me. That's probably the best intro I've ever had. The whole D1 athlete star. I don't really share that story much anymore, but I love it.
I got to do my research, man. I tell everybody, I can't have you come on the A-Game Podcast and give you a B or a C-game intro. It's gotta come tight, man. So
that was solid. Dude, I love it.
For people who maybe aren't 100% familiar with you and your background, yeah, can you give a little bit of a 30,000-foot view of who you are and where you came from?
Yeah, so Tommy Haar, born and raised in Columbus, Ohio, Pickerington, Ohio, to be specific. I grew up playing sports, was a Division I athlete, like you said, at the University of Dayton here in Ohio. Have that whole story of where I thought I was going to play professional sports, never knew what I was going to do. One of five kids, like you said, as well. And my dad's been an entrepreneur my whole life. So he had a property preservation business and a home inspection business. So I grew up trashing out houses, boarding up houses, changing locks, winterizing places. And that was around 08, 09. And then graduated college in 2017. That business had gone under, not under, but we closed the doors because there wasn't much foreclosures anymore. And became a home inspector. So just knew nothing about real estate, knew nothing about really anything. I knew I liked money. So I got a finance degree. Entrepreneurship was also a major at my school. So I was like, oh, I'm going to go work with my dad. So let's try that. But never knew anything about houses, but became a home inspector. So kind of followed my dad around for a year or two and just soaked up as much knowledge as I possibly could.
That's awesome, man. So I always think it's an interesting transition because a lot of the guys that come on the podcast, they're jiu-jitsu guys, they're UFC fighters, they're boxers or, you know, football guys. But I found that there's a very common denominator that athletes that transfer over to business tend to do really well. Yeah. What do you think it was in your experience coming from the athletic background that helped you excel in business?
To me, it's different probably than most what you hear. It's the injuries. So it was the getting kicked in the face and like having injuries and like you're the guy. It's like, and you're the guy and you get hurt and then you're kind of nobody at that point. So you got to work your way back up, work your way back into the team and have that unwavering belief in yourself more than anything. So I had some pretty serious injuries in college. One was should have been career ending. Worked back from that. Had my coaches telling me during that time period that I was a detriment to the team. I was on scholarship and they were like, hey, we don't even know why you're on the team anymore, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, I was heartbroken. I remember walking back to my dorm room, crying to my mom on the phone, like, I want to quit. I want to do this. But that drive and saying, okay, I'm not going to quit. I'm not going to give up because I know the end goal. That's directly correlated, in my opinion, to business. It's like, it's never going to be easy. You're going to get kicked in the mouth. You're going to get kicked in the teeth. You're going to want to quit. But if you're doing it for the right reasons, it's going to work out. You just got to stick to it and know your why.
That's awesome. And I feel like almost the same with the people that watch parents that had a secure job. And then they look at like the lack of stability there. I feel like that plays like an interesting role there, but you grew up around entrepreneurs, which a lot of people I speak to don't. Did that help you because you had already seen what it was like to have that roller coaster of ups and downs and the lack of actual security every month?
Yeah. So my dad never really shared the ups and downs as much. I got some good and some bad out of it. So the really good thing I got out of it was the work ethic. So one of five kids, I would always watch my dad wake up at 5 or 4:30 in the morning, hit the gym, and he'd be up on his laptop working, making breakfast for the kids, taking the kids all to school and going to work all day. But he was always there to coach. He was always there to be at all of our events. So the entrepreneurship, I saw lifestyle freedom, but I also saw that like sometimes it can be a hamster wheel as well. So I got to pull those aspects out into the business that I wanted to create. So work ethic is by far like one of the biggest things. Like you got to work your ass off no matter where you're at. But also that's why I transitioned out of home inspections, because it was a hamster wheel type business and I knew there was more to life. So I and they say like you can work hard as a coal miner, and you could say work the same amount of let's call it hardness as a real estate investor, and you can make way more money. So your dollar, not all money is created equal. So I learned that concept, learned about residual income, and went all in on investing, wholesaling first.
So I think it's another interesting thing. It says a lot about your character. I literally was just doing a conference I was speaking at, and somebody always brings up like, well, like, why didn't the home inspector just buy the property? Why didn't the contractor just become a real estate investor? How come if the realtor's getting you the deal, the realtor's just not buying all the properties? And yeah. I was like, I don't know what it is, but some people will just never change from that side that they have, like they're working for somebody versus working for themselves, even though they're literally all the people that I'm paying to do all the research on the property for me could easily be doing it themselves. They never will. What was it different about you that you decided to transfer over where most people don't?
So I started learning about wholesaling when I was probably 23. So my uncle put me on to Bigger Pockets. He asked me if I wanted to invest in real estate. So I started listening to Bigger Pockets. I started reading Rich Dad Poor Dad like everybody else. And, I mean, I just knew that there was more out there, and I wanted to take care of my parents long-term. So, short story, I bought my first house with my uncle. We partnered up. We ended up losing $100,000 on that first flip. And then I was still inspecting all day, every day, driving around, listening to Bigger Pockets. So I knew the concepts were right. I knew that this was going to work long-term. So I went to a couple of masterminds and I met some people, and I was in Cancun at a Tab Retreat. I don't know if you remember Tab Retreat or not. We were on the beach and I'd met this guy probably a year or two earlier. And he's like, dude, why are you still inspecting properties? It's like, well, I mean, I want to retire my parents. He's like, kind of like almost shook me. He was like, hey, like, if you inspect 1,000 more houses a year, is it going to retire your dad? And I was like, no. And there was some alcohol involved. And it was like, absolutely not. And he was like, he goes, so why are you still inspecting houses? And I was like, oh my God, you're right. So just like having people surrounded by me, or I surrounded people around me that like, they knew the bigger picture, and they had to kind of tell me like, hey, get yourself out of it. There's bigger things that you can do.
That's awesome, man. I love that. So it looks like your path to real estate came almost naturally because you were already doing trash outs and inspections and stuff for people in your area that were real estate investors. And shout out to Austin Rutherford, met him a bunch of times, been on the podcast, good guy. But was he initially like the catalyst that made you, was that the guy you had the conversation with?
So no. So he came into the picture. That's a good story with him. So I knew I wanted to, I'd done maybe a wholesale deal or two. I knew I wanted to get into real estate. And he was in Columbus crushing it. So I was this inspector. I was doing a lot of hard money draw inspections for every person flipping houses. And I was like, okay, I know this is what I want to do, but how do I get into this business? And how do I give value? Because that's what you hear on these podcasts. You got to give value. You got to give value. You got to give value. So I was like, okay. I started to realize that wholesalers didn't really know what they were looking at or what they were doing as far as rehab wise, or even the house itself. So I went to one of Austin's meetups after I figured out what I wanted to do. And I pulled him aside at the end. I said, hey, I see your wholesale deals. I see the pictures. The pictures suck. And I assume you pay a contractor $50 or a college student $50 to go take them. I'll do it for $75. I'll give you 150 pictures, 200 pictures, and I'll give you a 1-page report with it. How does that sound? So he's like, his name was Mo. So I talked to Mo, and the next day Austin calls me. He's like, hey, what were you talking about yesterday? Like, tell me that again. So he was like, let's run it. Let's try it. So I did a couple of those, and that really spread like wildfire. Like, it's super undervalued price wise, but the amount of connections and the amount of networking it allowed me to do and become the expert in that side and give actual value to people was immense. So not only was I becoming the expert in that field, I was also seeing all the wholesale deals and how people ran their operations from the back end. From being the person that was plug and play into their business. So with that small amount, the money wasn't even, I wasn't even thinking about the money. I was just thinking about the stuff that it was going to give me, and it worked exactly even better than how I had drawn it up.
Man, that is so wise beyond your years at the age that you are to see the value in, because especially I remember when I was like at your age, dude, that paycheck was everything. Like, you don't see the future there. I think it's like the, you know, that old thing that they used to do, the marshmallow test, where they give the kids a marshmallow and say, if you don't eat it now, you'll get another one in 20 minutes. And like the kids would always eat the marshmallow. So you waited on that. I think that that says a lot about your character and probably why you're successful now, because you see the long ball in the relationships. I think that that's beautiful. Because when we go to all these things, that, you know, one of the first things you hear is don't go up to people and ask them like, hey, like, what can you do for me? It's like, ask them, hey, what can I do for you? And I feel like you came with a value approach, which obviously paid off, man. So kudos to you for seeing that value.
Thank you. Yeah. It just allowed me to network with, like, I mean, most people, they go into those relationships exactly how you said. They're just asking how you, like, how can I extract stuff from you? But if you just sit there and like give them something they need, like, it's going to come back tenfold. So just, it just allowed me to put myself and sit at the table. And I knew, like, and when I got the chances, I asked the right questions. Like, I knew what I wanted, and I went for it.
That's awesome, man. So pivoting to what you were saying earlier about learning the lessons from the injuries. So talk about starting out when you were going through those first few deals. What are some of the beginner mistakes that you see when people are getting into wholesaling or flipping?
Yeah. So, I mean, wholesaling, people think it's going to come, like, you send marketing out and you immediately get deals. I mean, you start, you know, that's how I thought about it when I was listening to Bigger Pockets. I'm like, oh, this could be easy. You send out marketing and the phone rings and people start selling you their properties for pennies on the dollar. And that's obviously not true. Nobody taught me the consistency piece. So the injury stuff, in order to get back healthy, you have to be consistent. You have to show up every day. I was super inconsistent with my wholesaling. So I was not hitting the phones every day, and I'm sitting there kind of like, my mindset's changed so much since then. It's like, I'm kind of, woe is me. I was like, why isn't this working? Why isn't this working for me? It's because I wasn't putting in the constant effort every day. So that's one thing I always tell wholesalers, hey, but it's not going to be easy. It's going to take you 6 months to build up some sort of a pipeline to get somewhat consistent lead generation and deals. If you don't have any money, your effort has to be 10x that. But if you have a little bit of money, you can fuel the fire to get leads and start talking to sellers. So that was the lessons on the wholesaling. And then flipping is just, there's a learning curve. So you got to be able to find deals. You got to be able to evaluate deals. You got to be able to learn construction a little bit, because I didn't want to be the flipper that relied solely on what a contractor tells me, because that's what most people do. And you never know what's right and what's wrong. So you got to really learn the game, in my opinion.
So coming from that background now, and by the way, we'll talk a little bit about, we'll actually parlay back into that, because I like some of the stuff you're doing on social media with that. But so today, what is your buy box today? What's your business model today? Talk a little bit about your criteria and what you're doing.
Yeah. So our business model, so we have, let's call it three companies. So we have our wholesaling company, we have our fix and flip company, we have our buy and hold company. They all kind of work together. At least if we generate our own leads. So we're bringing anywhere from like 7 to 10 to 12 contracts in a month, a super lean budget. So we like to be very lean on the marketing side. So we'll source those, and we look at them three exits. Do we want to wholesale this? Do we want to take it down and flip? Or do we want to use the BRRRR method and keep it long-term as a rental? So as far as buy box goes, we don't have a super, super defined one. I'll take down 100-year-old houses, which we have those in Columbus. Stone foundations, lath, plaster, all that stuff, as long as the profit margin's enough. So I look at every deal kind of through the lens of, okay, how old is it? How big is the rehab? And what's my profit margin going to be on this thing? So if it's a newer build, 70s and above, I'm going to consider newer. Some listeners may think that's crazy if you're in like Texas or Arizona, but I'll take down a thinner deal for that. But if it's a big old house, I need way bigger margins.
That makes a lot of sense. So what are you doing as far as market adjustments? Because right now, obviously, things are a little bit of a volatile market, as far as you don't really know which way they're going to swing. Something's different every day. It seems to be holding up. But for those bigger rehabs now, what's your risk tolerance, or how are you adjusting to protect yourself in case of a market adjustment?
Yeah, I mean, I like to also sit in that first-time home buyer range. So in Columbus, Ohio, that's going to be 100,000 to 300,000 probably. So I'm not really taking down giant price-wise flips. So I'm not doing anything that's going to be super long-term and over $500,000. I don't want to tie up that much money. Luckily, that my market allows that. So I'm also pricing in the uncertainty. So my profit margin, I mean, if I take down a 100-year-old flip and I'm going to put 150 grand into it, my on paper margin has to be 75,000 to 100 grand, because that easily is becoming 50, 40, then to 30 with over rehabbing, which always happens. And then a market adjustment, then you're screwed. So just being very careful about those, and then throwing out top comps, making sure you're running your ARV super conservatively, and looking at just the for sales in the area too, like what's contingent, what's not, being able to kind of read what the future is going to do.
That's awesome. Yeah. I'm a big believer now, where I used to spread out very wide, but I really like the idea of really getting to know your market, because when you're looking at it every day, you have a really good pulse for like where things are going. And that's going to give you those adjustments to know where to go, where not to go, how to adjust those numbers and all that fun stuff. But you mentioned BRRRR. So for anybody who's not familiar with that term, buy, rehab, rent, refinance, and then repeat, 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 depending on how many R's you want to throw on there. Are you having any issues or adjustments with lenders right now on the refinance side? Because that's always one of those iffy things that people don't talk as much about. Like, I got the margin in there, but with the risk tolerance of the banks, are you seeing any adjustments on the refi for what they want from the property or what they want from the borrower?
Yeah, I mean, it's mostly the borrower. I mean, we're doing a decent amount of DSCR stuff. So it's more straight cash flow and DSCR. So your debt service. So they want to see 1.2 plus. They want to see a minimal 700 plus credit score to get anything in the, even in the eights. So if you have lower than 700 credit score, you're going to get nine. And this is November 2nd. So you're going to be in the nines in interest rate. So a single family home doesn't really cash flow that way. So if we are, and we're not holding as much right now, just to be completely honest, it just doesn't make that much sense unless it's a killer deal. We'll look at interest only options as well, to especially if we get a 75% LTV loan, we have the equity. I'll take an IO loan to maybe cash flow a little bit with the idea of refinancing in 2 to 3 years in the future. So kind of stuff your pockets now with the cash flow, because your principal pay down in the beginning of those loans is really marginal anyway. So take that cash flow up front. Hopefully the house doesn't depreciate. If it stays at the value it's at, you can refinance in the future, barring a crazy prepayment penalty. So just trying to be creative on that end.
That's awesome. That makes a lot of sense. And like you said, the more real estate you can get your name on, man, it's very forgiving. Even if we do see a little bit of a dip, you hold that for 5 or 10 years, especially in a market like Columbus, man, every day people are getting turned on to Columbus. Yeah, so crazy. I think it's a good strategy, man.
Thank you. All right, so
breaking down some of like the peers of this now, acquisitions, rehab, dispositions are kind of the key when we, you know, obviously funding and stuff like that. So I want to hear a little bit about like what you're doing or what you're seeing, starting with acquisitions. So acquisitions, what are some of your strategies right now for finding deals?
Yeah, so our bread and butter for the last 4 years has been texting and cold calling. So we use Launch Control for texting. We use REI Sift, which Tyler's also in the Family Mastermind. So REI Sift's been a pillar of our business for probably 2 or 3 years. So we pull PropStream lists, pretty much that's it for paid lists. And then we mix them with county lists. So free, so your eviction lists, your tax delinquents, all that stuff. Throw them into REI Sift, because if you have enough data, you're going to start seeing the same points. I don't want to re-skip trace those. So it's going to stack those for us. And if they're super targeted, we'll hand dial those people. But most of those lists are going to go directly out to our cold callers. So we've got 5 cold callers in Egypt, maybe 6 now. And then we run a Launch Control account. And that consistently brings us probably 7 to 10 leads a day.
So that's a really interesting topic for today. As you said, the end of like kind of Q4, 2023, Launch Control, texting, SMS, there's a whole thing right now about that. Oh, yeah. That's going away. I literally just got a text from somebody like, oh, that's going out. But I just, right before I talked to you, I was on a thing with Launch Control.
Yeah,
I'm a big believer in when people are running away from something, it's going to create a little bit more of an opportunity. Yep. You just have to learn the rules to play by it. So are you one of those believers now who is sticking with SMS, or are you ditching it and running for the hills?
No, I'm sticking with it. My partner was actually on that same call. So we're going to stick with it. We're going to play within the boundaries, and exactly what you said. I mean, people are going to run and go jump to the next thing. I like staying in what I know. And if that, I mean, hopefully not to a fault, but I think that there's going to be opportunity.
I agree with you, man. 100%. Cool. So another area here is rehabbing. Now there's a bunch of different things we can go into with rehabbing, but especially we're going to talk about your social media stuff, but I love what you've been doing out there with showing the components and what the things cost and what behind the walls are, man. Like that's one of the best things I see out there right now. Like just the visual and kind of the true cost of all that stuff. I like what you're doing out there, man. But
one of my
first things is, did your background as a home inspector help you to understand construction and rehabbing?
Absolutely. I mean, I didn't get paid much at all. And I didn't really deserve to get paid that much. I was young and it was kind of like it's a beginner job, right? So even if it's my dad or not, it's so funny. Side note, like I'll post that, hey, I've got 65 rentals. I started as a home inspector, making 40 grand a year, and I'll get comments and people are like, oh, so daddy helped you out. I'm like, dude, Did you just not read that I was making $32,000 a year working for my dad? Like, what tells you there that he was helping me out? Like, obviously, they helped me out and it's amazing, but like, that's not really much of a like Donald Trump $1 million loan type thing, right? So, but home inspections, man, I mean, being able to just walk houses every single day, like five houses a day between all, you see everything and a full gut rehab. From a hard money loan bank side, I get to see their budgets. So like there was a time period when everybody was using hard money. Lima One Capital was the big one in Columbus at the time. This was probably 2018. I was looking at 10, 20 full scope of work budgets a week. And I was being able to like visualize as I walked in, and I didn't know it at the time. It was just like, this is on site, like real fix and flip training. And I was getting to see real numbers and kind of just as time went on, see good rehabs. I got to see really bad rehabs. I got to meet really good contractors and really bad ones. So if somebody was in there and doing really good work, I would ask them for their number. If they were doing really bad, I would stay very far away from that contractor. And then just being able to like know now, like pockets, I was driving around for every day and every zip code. So if you tell me a street in Columbus, I can probably tell you the zip code. I can probably tell you the age of the house. I could probably now tell you the ARV of the house. So without even looking at Zillow. So just really getting a really good microeconomic background of that. And then also knowing ages of homes and components, it was just an absolute game changer when I decided to start buying.
Man, that's such a great extensive background to have. I think some of the biggest things I've learned over the years on the rehab side has been by going over my home inspection reports with my home inspector. It's just a huge thing. And I always go in like this time machine in my head of like, if I could go back, like what would help me out? And sometimes I'm like, finance, economics, contractor, but I think I would still go back to home inspector. I think that's probably where I would land on, man. So that's awesome stuff.
Yeah, it was now, super cool.
Sorry, go ahead.
I also got to work with my dad every day. I mean, not everybody can say they can do that. So it was just, it was so fun. Just like shooting the shit on the, like, we'll be on a roof. And my dad's like a big kid. He just like, will crack jokes and just it would have a lot of fun while we were doing it. So that's what I really miss about it.
That's cool, man. That's awesome. So on the rehab side, again, one of the things I tell people is some of the ways you're going to get your butt kicked on flipping. One of them is going to be, obviously, ARV could be messed up. The other one could be that your construction budget, they could either go over budget or then go over rehab. Over the timeline. But the other thing is I tell people you have to manage that contractor the right way. And that was something I think I messed up huge when I first started, was not checking in on them daily, not having those upfront contracts, not having those expectations and those good lines of communication. So after doing so many rehabs, like aside from just the actual nuts and bolts of keeping somebody on time and on budget, what are some tips you have to like manage that relationship during the renovations with the contractor?
Sure. Man, it's not an easy thing. So it's a lot of emotional intelligence. It's a lot of like, cause not every contractor is going to be the same. But you said it in the middle there, it's expectation. So if you work with me and my company, we set the expectation up front before a hammer ever gets swung. To me, the biggest thing that people mess up is the payment schedule. So most contractors, when they finish, they're calling you no matter what. And that could be that same night. It could be a Saturday night. It could be a Sunday morning. You could be at church and they're calling you, hey, I'm done. Where's my money? if they work for me and my company, they need to bill me by Monday to be paid out by Friday. So they need to invoice what was done per scope of work on Monday to my team. So now we have 4 days to do a bunch of things. Number one is to look over the work. We actually go to the houses and make sure that that work is actually done and done well. Number two, if we don't have any money in our bank account, that gives us 4 days to scramble and figure out how we're going to pay these guys. Because no matter what, you're getting paid on Friday. So it allows us to get a hard money draw inspection, allows us to pull private money, allows us to shift money around in bank accounts. And then number three, it lets them know that they're not working for a mom and pop business. It lets them know that, hey, these people are actually serious. This has to go to the accounting, even if it's just you. Hey, this has to go through my accounting department. It has to get approved by the bookkeeper, all this stuff to know, okay, holy shit, I can't just call Tom on a Tuesday night at midnight and threaten him for his money because you set the expectation up front. If that makes sense. That was a big change in our big change in our business. Finish quality expectations was big. I'm not huge on like timeline expectations unless it's egregious. I think that's one thing I'll be a little more lenient on. But quality is a big thing. So like floors, trim, caulking, like just really fine finish work, even if it's not nice materials, it still needs to be installed well.
I joke around. I say the two things that I have is I get contractors that can do a job on budget, and then I get a contractor that can do a job on time. But I've rarely found the ones that can do both. So I'm trying to have two of them have a baby together that maybe I can hire. But yeah. Where's your thoughts on that? Because the ones that I see, Rick, really race to hit that finish line, the quality is, I mean, that's the stuff that the buyers see. They don't see all this stuff behind the walls and all that kind of stuff. No. So like, where's that fine line of like, how do you keep them somewhere? Like, do you put a cushion in there for, you know, they said 4 weeks, you're just going to budget six, knowing that it's going to take a little bit longer. Like, how do you balance out that fine line between letting them slack off, but actually giving them a realistic expectation?
Man, I mean, it's so hard to kind of say. It's contractor by contractor, because you got what, like you said, time, speed, and quality, or time, money, and quality. So you're never going to get all three together. So you got to just kind of upfront pick it. So if you're doing maybe a rental turn in an area that's not amazing, and you know you're not going to put out the best product, which may happen. I don't do a lot of that, but sometimes I may choose for speed and inexpensive, but the quality may lack. So you got to just like know upfront what you're getting with that specific contractor first. And then, I mean, I think having like, we have a project manager and we have a runner. So the runner goes and he's taking pictures of properties pretty much every day of the week. So letting the contractors know we're in there looking over their shoulders, and like, we're not just leaving you for weeks and letting you take pictures of the property. We have people going and looking and reporting back to me every night in an end of day email. So my project manager sends me an EOD every night of updated pictures, all a summary of the big ticket items of every project, so I can get on the contractor's asses if need be.
That makes a lot of sense. Do you pay them like per job, or do you put your project manager on a salary?
So project manager salary with incentivizations on timelines and also budget. So awesome. if they kick ass, get it done fast, and get on budget, you get a nice bonus.
That's awesome, man. The last kind of rehab thing I'd like to ask here is, different markets right now are all over the spectrum for where they are as far as supply chain and permits and inspections. Are you factoring that in by like just following up with the city or seeing how long it's taking on your deals? And is there like that fine line of, you know, you won't do X, Y, and Z because it's going to take B, C, and D to get that done with the city and all that kind of stuff?
Sure. Yeah. I mean, there's certain jurisdictions in Columbus that, you know, right away that if you're dealing with them, add 3 months to your budget, like minimum. So we know that going in, and it's just got to be baked into our profit margins, right? So not only like it's opportunity cost of your contractors, it's also your time and your headache. Like you could be making, let's call it 75 grand on paper, but if you got to deal and go out to that property 30 times to meet inspectors and stuff, like what's your time really worth at the end of the day? So your profit margin on that's maybe like 30. It's like you're wasting so much time and manpower that you could be using on another quick cosmetic rehab, maybe two of them that you can make up that money for. So we're always looking at, hey, what's our manpower at that time? If we have a crew that can do it and we're not overly busy, let's take it on. But if we have a bunch of other stuff in the pipeline, let's pass on it.
That's really good info, man. And you know, on the contractor selection side, obviously you're dealing with a lot of referrals and stuff, but let's say you call me, you say, hey, Nick, you got a contractor. I send you over, I vouch for them. What are some like quick and dirty things you look for to see if this person's even worth you having a conversation with or sending out to bid a job?
Number one, timeliness to get back to me. That if they take forever to get back to me, I don't even want to talk to them. If they're late to meet me on site, then that's a big no-no. They don't let me walk a property of theirs or a project. If they keep a dirty work site, I don't like that either. And then immediately if they start bad mouthing other people immediately, so blaming others and not taking like, let's call it extreme ownership for things, I don't even want to work with those people. I've been burned so many times by people right away just saying, oh, well, you know, like, this last person did this to me. It's like, this is going to happen to me. I'm going to be that next person. So I try to stay away from those people. And then like, if it's a referral from you, I hold my that weight in gold. So also how they answer the phone. So if I call somebody and it's like, they're like, hey, how's it going? It sounds like they just woke up. It's noon. I'm like, all right, I'm not even going to try it. So a lot of things that are mixed in.
Dude, that's fantastic. That's really good info there. So
if you have been kicking yourself that you didn't start investing in real estate sooner, whether you're beginner, intermediate, or advanced, any way you're looking to get in on a residential, commercial, land development, wholesaling, fix and flips, whatever it is, let's find a way to get you involved in some projects, get you some properties, whether you want to sell some properties to me whether you want to buy some properties from me, whether residential, fix and flip, cash flow, multifamily, whatever it is you're looking for, let's figure out a way to get you involved or find a way for us to partner up on some deals. Go to www.nicknicknick.com. Go on the consultation tab and figure out how to schedule an appointment to talk about where you fit in if you are not sure, or you can just reach out to me on any of my social media channels. If you go on www.nicknicknick.com/links, you will see all the different ways to connect with me and figure out how we can start to work together, make it happen. Everybody that invests in real estate always just says they wish they did it sooner. Best time to start is today.
Transitioning now, pivoting over from the rehabbing, let's talk about now the dispositions. Now, obviously, if it's a flip, pretty easy, listed with a realtor, throw on the market, get rid of it. But on the wholesale side now, I'm very interested to see what you're doing to dispo those properties, because the market shifted a little bit, buyer criteria shifted a little bit, and that's a little bit of a gray area now. So talk about how you're dispositioning deals Q4 2023.
Yeah, we're hitting the phones hard. We just hired dispo again out. So literally 3 weeks ago, hired another full-time person. We are combing through our buyers list. We probably have, let's call it 8 to 10,000 people on there. We're calling everybody. We're getting everybody on the phone. We're asking them if they're still buying, what's their criteria, what's their exact zip code they want to buy in, because it's not enough to send an email anymore. I mean, if this was 2-3 years ago, you post on Facebook, you send an email, a deal sold, and you're a rock star. Like, I thought I was the dispo man back then. But it's just like, no, you just kind of sold it to a hedge fund and it was easy, right? So really getting targeted. So our podio is built out to where, like, I need to know their zip code and their buying criteria. And also, like, asking the probing questions of, how do you buy? So is it cash? Is it hard money? Because I know if it's hard money, I now know that I have to prep the seller for probably another walkthrough. And if we didn't do that on the acquisition side, set that expectation, then it might get squirrely. So I need to be able to set the tone for the rest of the walkthroughs. And really kind of setting, and we have to set walkthroughs now. I tried to tiptoe around it for a while. You have to set walkthroughs and you have to incite some FOMO. So you have to be like, hey, get everybody in at one time, let them see the other people that are coming to bid on the property and get them to bid each other up a little bit.
That's really good. And I think that probably makes life a little bit easier dealing with the seller too, when you give them one or two time slots, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Nice, man. So the reverse engineering there, is that part of, like, how do you track all that? Because when you're looking at, now you're talking to all these buyers and they're giving you all this different buying criteria. When you get a deal now, how do you sort it to say, like, oh, well, this is going to work for Jimmy, but it's not going to work for Nick, but it's going to work for Timmy, but not for Jane. Like, how does that all come together?
Yeah. So our podio, we have tags for everything. So if it's a zip code, so hopefully it was zip, or at least like we wrote out the city. So then our VAs will go in and scrub those on the back end and pop in the zip codes for us. But it's filtering it as close down as we can. And then just hand dialing those people, we call it a snipe. So we want to snipe those buyers, as well as like our mass marketing efforts. So we want to text the deal out. We want to still email it out, because you never know who's going to see it. But I want the people that I know that I talk to see that deal and like personalize, hey, we have this deal, we talked about it, boom. So sometimes right now you just got to hand it on a platter like this to them, to where it's just impossible to say no.
Love that, man. So you mentioned VAs. Let's talk a little bit about how are you using your VAs right now for your business?
Oh, okay. So we have quite a few VAs. So not like some people where they have like 20, but we have two VAs that work full-time in our wholesaling business. We'll probably get another for dispo here soon, but lead management, skip tracing, data mining, basically like doing everything data-wise. If we like driving for dollars chat in our Slack, if we drive by a house, they'll grab it, scrub it, and make sure that we hand dial them or whatever it is. So making sure that the marketing engine is always rolling. So that was the first thing we saw in our wholesaling business that we had to build out, because that is the most important part of the business, is to keep leads coming in, but it's the most boring and the most tedious low level stuff to do, but it needs done. So outsourcing that immediately to VAs and building out really strong SOPs on that to where they can just run it themselves. So at this point, Aura, she's been with us 2 years, a little over 2 years. She knows more about REI SIFT and she knows more about pulling lists than me or my business partner do at this point. She literally trains other VAs for other people now.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Now, how do you interact though? So like, what does your day-to-day look like? How often are you checking in with them? I assume you're using like WhatsApp or Slack or Zoom or something along those lines.
Yeah. So we'll Zoom with them on like acquisitions meetings and touch bases. And then we're texting back and forth on Slack within our entire company pretty much all day.
Nice, man. And then how do you train? Do you like onboarding, or I'm assuming like you're probably outsourcing the onboarding now, but were you doing that initially?
I mean, we still do a lot of the onboarding because we don't like our retention rate with our VAs is really high. We pay them well and like we treat them as part of the company. I think people get that pretty wrong too, is like use them as means to an end and talk to them maybe as lessers, but like they're massive parts of our business. But we make sure that up front, before we start even to hire, we have most of our SOPs built. We have a lot of screen recordings made. They're all in folders. And then we pretty much just do the business live with them when we train. And if you do it one time and you record it, there you go. You got your training manual right there.
That's smart, man. I always tell myself I'm going to record all this stuff. And then while I'm in the middle of doing it, I'm like, I don't want to start over. I'll do it next time. And then next time comes into never. So I just have to have a little bit of discipline on that, man. So
yeah.
Awesome, brother. So that's been really helpful information. I think that there was key takeaways that you gave for every aspect of that, which is probably why you are a social media star, sir. That's why you have so many followers. That's why you've done such a great job. But, you know, Family Mastermind, I see people posting. Everyone's like, man, Tommy Haar, he's the social media guy, man. He's got it down. He's got it locked in. You know, for anybody who's not, obviously, we'll put all the links in the show notes. But your social media is outstanding, man. You give great content. It's informative. It's entertaining. It's really good stuff, man. So talk a little bit about, first off, how are you using social media for your business?
Yeah. So a lot of it's non-direct ROI stuff. So stuff you can't really have. It's not tangible. So building a brand. So you can sell stuff in the future, but one is just like, is my name synonymous with good business? Is my name synonymous with like teaching people the right things for real estate? And if somebody finds a deal in Columbus, who are they gonna think of? Hopefully they think of me. So giving education, and then private money, man, being able to raising capital is one of my big things in our business. So it's been unbelievable. Just like people lend me quarter millions of dollars. I've never met them before in my life. It's straight from Instagram. So if sometimes I'll like, it really blows me away sometimes because I'll post about it. If I'm like really in a tight spot and I got to figure out how to fund a deal, I'll be like, hey, I got this investment. I'll get like 10 DMs and be like, hey, I'm in. I followed you for 3 years. I'm ready to go. I trust you. It's like, holy shit. That's good. I've been building this up for time and time again. It's consistency.
Yeah, man. The social proof, that credibility is money, man. I think, again, it goes back to a different version, but the same principle of what you did with the home inspection business. You're putting in the time now that's going to pay you out later. And obviously that's done that. So yeah. I know everybody who watches Tommy and Austin Rutherford goes, yeah, I'm going to start a TikTok and I'm going to have 100,000 followers and I'm going to make, but you see, it's not all like, it's very hard, especially with Instagram. I'm surprised you've had such growth on it because it seems tougher and tougher to get organic growth and to really hack those algorithms. So talk a little bit about some of your keys to how you've grown such a huge audience on social media in such a small amount of time.
Yeah, man. So, I mean, I've been consistently posting for over 2 years every day. So I, a little backstory about that is Austin was a big catalyst to that. So he's one of my business mentors and a great friend now. Doing business, and I post on my stories a lot, but he's like, dude, you got to like post on social media, like really like show people what you're doing. So hired my first content guy probably 2 years ago. He would fly in from Georgia. He'd follow me around for two or three days out of the week and just shoot everything we did. And the content sucked. I mean, it was just like, it wasn't great. We were just kind of walking around and it just, there was no flow to it. There was no, like, you get some good stuff if you watch long enough, but it wasn't really gaining traction. And I'm not a very patient person either. So it was really testing me. And I was like, I know I want to do this. And I made the commitment to myself. Once I started social media, can't stop. So it's a commitment because you're putting yourself out there and you can't start and stop. I look at it as a perpetuity thing. Once you start, there's no end to it. You got to continuously show up. So when I realized that wasn't working, I watched the Layla Hormozi video. It just popped up on my timeline. And she her and Alex Hormozi are amazing. They're, some of their concepts they give out are fantastic. But they were like, listen, the guys that had doing content, great for doing content. I applaud you, but your life's not that cool. You don't need a cameraman following you around to everywhere you go and recording your conversations, all that stuff. And I was like, yeah, that's true. That what you need to do is you need to digest, let's call it on a Sunday, digest everything you did that week, write it out, and write and shoot content on that. You're still telling what you did. You may not catch like some crazy things in the moment, but that's okay. Because most of my stuff's education. I'm not trying to like really show like theatricals. So that really changed my entire business for social media, because I now write out every single video you watch. Every word that you see come out of my mouth is written. I write the hooks. I write the entire script. I write the body. I create the automations. I do everything.
That's incredible, man. Again, how you do anything is how you do everything. So that's probably why you're successful in real estate and on social media. You know, the last key point I want to ask about that is our Sam Prim. He was a mastermind guy. Guy's killing it right now. But I watched him. He's got this crazy social media following. He drops all this really good content. And then I made the mistake of reading the comments one day. The amount of hate and just shit talking and ridiculous comments that were completely inaccurate for like a 30-second post. And I felt bad for him, you know, even though I was like, he doesn't care. He's probably not even reading it. The guy's doing good. But when you put yourself out there, I think a lot of people, I was just having this conversation. Never in my life have I been the person who left a shitty or a hateful comment on somebody else's content. I just, you know, why would you? If I don't like it, I'm just not going to post anything. But people put so much effort into hating and negativity and all that stuff for somebody who's just trying to put some good content out there. And I think it's part of the reason why, as much as people want to be Tommy Haar, they don't really want to put themselves out there and have that vulnerability. How do you handle the haters?
I mean, first thing I do is go to their page. If it bothers, so sometimes it'll bother me, and like I'll be like, man, like F this guy, like what? So I'll go to their page and it's one picture of their dog, and I was like, okay, and they got 12 followers. It's like, okay, like they're not even showing their face, so it's like, okay, I'm just gonna completely forget about this person. And then usually, like if I like say I have a couple beers in me, and I'll snap back at some people. I'll be like, oh, I'm so sorry who hurt you that day. Like, I hope you have a better day. God bless you. And just like, be like, you know what? I don't know what you have going on in your life. Everybody has problems. Everybody has issues. If you want to project that on me, if you want me to be the trampoline for that, go ahead. I don't really care. I'm going to be successful no matter what you say about me on my post. So, and it's also propelling my algorithm. So if you're posting a comment, people are going to see it more. So comment away. And I don't really post more. The posts that I do go viral, it's more like fringy of like where you do get hate stuff. But you kind of just let it bounce off your chest, man.
Yeah, no, that's smart. My buddy, I should actually get him as part of a family mastermind, but Kevin Shippey, he's got a great shout out. Two guys take on real estate, amazing social media content, but they just started doing a session, I guess, that they have like, and it's where he reads all of his hate and he like responds.
It's fantastic.
He always starts out with, well, first and foremost, Tommy, thank you for helping our algorithm, because millions of people are going to see this now because you keep shitting all over my posts. But it is just one of those things. I guess it's just perspective. So
absolutely.
Dude, I don't want to take up your whole day. A couple of more things here that I just want to kind of go over when we go here. First off, I like to call this the victory lap, where we ask a couple of final questions and snip things together. And I definitely want to hear about how you're helping people. I want to talk about the class coming up in December, where people can find you and learn from you. But my first question of the victory lap was, dude, how was Egypt? I've always wanted to go there. It's freaking amazing you just went there.
Egypt was great. It was great. And it's crazy. I mean, just going to different cultures, I've always said, like, just gives you such a different perspective on life, man. So in college, I had Ghanaian roommates. People literally had never been to America. They come straight from Ghana, and you just learn so much like about what life's really about. Like a lot of this stuff is vanity. So perspective was awesome, seeing the old stuff, but also been very impoverished. I mean, it's just tough how people live. So very cool, but very, very surreal at the same time.
Was it one of those things? Cause you hear from everybody like, you don't want to go there. It's not safe. But I know not that many people have gone there, but I don't know anybody that came back and was like, I got mugged, they got shot, I got threatened. Yeah. Like everybody kind of has a great story.
Yeah. It's all about like, hopefully I only really go places. I mean, not always, but with places I have connections at. So if you have a person that's from there, they can kind of steer you around the right way. And having a good host is really important.
Man, those periods, the pyramids are definitely a bucket list type of thing there, man. What was it? Did it have like a different energy? Did it feel surreal?
I mean, everybody's kind of throwing around the idea of like, there's no way this was man-made. That whole thing was always floating around. I mean, the blocks are they're humongous. So I mean, it kind of gives you, and they're so old. It's just like you kind of put it in the perspective of America's however old, and this is like way, way before. So it's like, oh my God, this is. I live in this little bubble of who I am right now, and there's just so much more.
Dude, those pyramids, that'll give your 100-year-old house a rehab run for its money, huh?
That's
If something
right.
goes
That's
wrong over
right.
there, it's
Yeah,
a lot of permits you got to pull. Awesome, man.
I
So I know you're a reader, man. So talk about what's a book that's influenced your life?
mean. There's a decent amount of books that influenced my life. I'm gonna just talk about the last one. I just read Shoe Dog, by Phil Knight, the founder of Nike. It just the perspective of seeing just how long it takes to really build a business and bootstrap something and go through the highs and the lows, and mostly lows, because you only see somebody where they're at right now, and you don't know all the stuff they went through to get there. So if you've not read that, it's just, I mean, they were making millions of dollars at one point, and he would go home to his wife and be like, we could go under tomorrow. And everybody's seeing you doing all these great things, and like from the outside looking in, you're killing it, but like it could all be gone tomorrow. So it's like the risks of entrepreneurship, and just lets you feel better that like you're not the only one ever going through that. I feel like the founder of one of the biggest brands ever went through that for years. It just gave me a lot of good stuff.
That's a good one, man. Actually, I haven't heard that one yet. I'm going to pick that up today. That's good stuff.
Great book, great book.
What is one of your favorite quotes?
I would say the quote, I might butcher it, but you overestimate what you can do in a day and you underestimate what you can do in a year. So a lot of people, especially when they get into a business, especially with social media, with the fuel behind that, like, oh, I'm gonna go start, let's call it wholesale. I'm gonna go wholesale. I'm gonna crush it right away. It doesn't work like that. Ed Milet calls it compound pounding. You can't see really what you're doing on a day-to-day basis, but you look back, we look at everything in our business on a 90-day term. If you look back 90 days, you can really start to see needles start to move, but you can't really see it from a true day-to-day perspective. So starting to see your time in chunks and just being able to see how your efforts are really compounding.
That's good, man. I like that. I never actually heard that term before. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Very nice. Any quick references to a real estate nightmare that you've had on one of your deals?
I mean, I lost $100,000 on my first flip.
That's pretty
Me and my
bad.
uncle. It's pretty bad. So I'll never forget Austin, one of his meetups. They're like, how many people have lost money in real estate? And I mean, there's probably 100 people in this room. So 100 people in the room. And like, I raise my hand. Not many people raise their hand. They're like, okay, how about 30 grand? A couple people put their down, 50 grand, boom. And like, I was the only one after 50 grand. He's like, how much you lose? I was like, 100 grand. Everybody's like, oh. So I mean, it just taught me it probably can't get worse than that. You got to keep going. All bad things turn good if you hold it, if you keep holding on long enough. And it taught me a lot about contracting. It taught me a lot about not everything's gonna be wins, not everything's like social media. And I learned that first, which is great because it was the first lesson I had.
What was it that went wrong that cost you so much money?
So we overshot ARV. So it was a 6-bed, 5-bath house, 4,000 square foot in a very nice area. Overshot ARV, undershot rehab, undershot timelines, kind of like the concoction for failure, you know? So, and I didn't fire my contractor fast enough. I didn't fire him really at all. So I knew I should have and just never did. I didn't know better.
Man, I could check every one of those boxes, so don't feel bad as you know. Probably everybody has made every one of those mistakes probably multiple times, man. So I feel for you. But
Absolutely.
that is why we met at a place like a mastermind, and we're both big and we invest in ourselves. We invest in education constantly because those mistakes, I tell everybody, you're going to pay for your education one way or another. And as cliche as that sounds, the differences in real estate, those mistakes could be 70, 90, $100,000. And if you don't know what you're doing, you don't have a bunch of money, you might not ever recover from that. So
Absolutely.
talk about real side real estate education that you're doing. I know you got a class coming up in December. I might be there. I'm hoping some of our listeners might be there. So this is probably airing mid-November, so not that far away. They could be jumping in
Yeah.
and learning from you. So talk a little bit about what you got going on there.
Yeah, so the workshop is a we'll call an intermediate wholesaling workshop. So we're going to come in and teach you how to scale from let's say, inconsistent leads and deals. So if you're the, if you're that type of person that gets a deal here and there, get a little lucky with or unlucky with leads, we're going to teach you how to consistently get your lead flow in, train and hire virtual assistants to build your lower level of your business, make maybe even hire salespeople, KPIs. We're going to build out your SOPs, talk about transaction coordination, acquisitions, like talk about every piece of the buckets, talk SOPs and how you can really build out a wholesaling business and have consistency with lead flow and deal flow to where you don't have to really worry about where that next deal is coming from. Because, you know, if you do the right outputs or the right inputs, so like the right amount of calls, the right amount of leads, you're going to get deals. So we're going to be teaching that December 4th and 5th in Columbus, Ohio. We'd love to have you guys there. I'll also throw in $500 off for anybody that comes here. It's 2000 bucks, but take $500 off for anybody that wants to come from this podcast. And we'd love to have anybody. And that also will give you access to the Real Side of Real Estate community. So it's a community we built probably 8 to 10 months ago. We have a little over 100 people in there right now, like-minded individuals that want to learn how to wholesale and how to flip. We call it the real side of real estate because we're not teaching you like rah-rah-y stuff. It's not like, it's not just random theory. It's real life scenarios. It's real tactical things that you can go out and do tomorrow to actually do deals and learn the real way of investing. We don't hide the losses. We don't, you learn from the losses. There's two live calls a week. I've got one tonight at 7. We're going to teach the permitting process for construction. So teaching the nitty gritty and, just there's a lot more to it, but that's the basics.
And it's going to be actually you teaching it.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's pretty badass, man. I love that. So anybody starting out, man, you want to learn from somebody who's made those mistakes or just you don't have to. I'm a big believer on that timeline. And when people, even if they do start to take some action, I always refer to it as the onion. You've, I see this. This is good. And then you get in there, you're like, oh, there's so much more that I didn't even notice or see in there, man. So I think the value for what you're doing, man, is absolutely incredible. A guy who's actually in there doing this business every single day, making money in a market like this when a lot of people are sitting on the sidelines, and especially understanding the disposition side and the rehab side right now that are changing so much. Guys that are doing, like, I'm selling myself. I'm probably going to be there. So if you guys are listening and you want to go attend, what are some ways they can contact you about the course? Talk about how they can find you, how they can find all your stuff on social media.
Yeah. So hit me up on Instagram, TommyHard05. I respond to all my DMs. Followers almost mean nothing. Like I'm just a normal Midwest guy. So I like to help people out. Shoot me a DM. Understand that, like, if you ask me a 30-page book, I may not be able to answer all of it, but I'm gonna answer the best of my ability. But shoot me a DM on Instagram. If you want to learn about the workshop, just shoot me a message workshop, and I'll even hop on a phone call and see if you're a good fit.
That's awesome, man. I really appreciate it. And that's very noble of you, sir, to give the discount. I didn't realize you're going to do that. So huge value there, man. I think it's awesome. You, sir, obviously bring your A-game to everything you do in life or you wouldn't be where you are today. This interview has been no different. You definitely brought your A-game to this podcast today. Any final thoughts before I let you go, my friend?
No, man. I know we're in the same mastermind. So just put yourself around people that are winning, whether it's starting your own little networking group, getting around people that think the same way you do. It's going to elevate your game. So I know me and Nick are going to have great memories here in the future. I know it's the start of a really good lasting relationship, and can't wait to see what you do in the future too, man.
Likewise, man. I look forward to joining you on your journey, and we have to make up for not getting dinner in Tampa, man. That whole thing, those 3 days like freaking shot by, man. So definitely got to make a plan to link up, and I'll touch base with you after this because I definitely want to talk to you about coming out to Ohio soon. Tommy Hart, ladies and gentlemen, have a fantastic day. Thank you so much for coming on, sir. I really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me, brother.
Have a good day, man.